questions, and I've been asked to answer one of them, but I might go through many of them quickly. They're sent from the ISKCON Daiva Varnashram Ministry, headed by His Holiness Bhakti Raghav Maharaj. For more on these topics, I've spoken extensively on these things, on Varnashram topics. Within our movement at the present time, it's considered that there are some Varnashram fanatics who they talk about it, and it's just what some people do. Those of you who read Srila Prabhupada's books regularly, and I hope that includes most of you, so I presume that you're getting inspiration by regularly reading Srila Prabhupada's books. Those who regularly read Srila Prabhupada's books, and also if you listen to Srila Prabhupada's recordings of his lectures and his conversations, you'll find that it's a point that Srila Prabhupada very much stressed. It's not some imagination that some of his followers have got something popped into their head, Varnashram, but it's something that Srila Prabhupada, and he writes in his purports that the purpose of this Krishna consciousness movement is to establish Varnashram. So of course, he writes many things as the purpose. So it is of major, it's not my trip. It's not Bhakti Raghav Swami's fascination. This is an order given by Srila Prabhupada to all of his followers. So I'm touching on what are the main, question 13, what are the main stumbling blocks for Varnashram to happen? The main stumbling block is that we as a movement are not taking it seriously. Because if we did, considering the resources that ISKCON has now, compared to 1977 when Srila Prabhupada left, there's so many householders, there's so many devotees. What's stopping us? Why can't we do it? The leaders have to get into it. Could we please turn that light there? It's just right shining in my eyes. This light, in the hallway, I think it is. Yeah, these halogen lamps. Horrible things. It's another reason to go to the farms. No electric lights, no electricity. That's another stumbling block because people don't think they can live with such. We're addicted to this sense gratification society. We think we'd rather slog hard, work very hard, and live in the polluted, horrible city than go to a peaceful place where we can, without any pressure, major pressure of time, we can 3 times a day have Krishna satsanga, 3 times a day. In our farm in Gujarat, they have morning program, midday program, and evening program. So if we consider that our goal of life is to become Krishna conscious, then we should live with devotees and maximize our hearing and chanting about Krishna and and avoid bad association, live simply, but it is not being preached, hardly. And we think that, well, most of the people are in the cities, so we should stay in the cities to preach. But it's also the order Srila Prabhupada gave, 50% of my mission. I still have to do 50%. Which, if you think about it, that's amazing, because what Prabhupada did was amazing. Now we look back and we don't think it's amazing, but it was amazing at the time. And even when Srila Prabhupada first of all, Prabhupada went to the West, and no one thought he was going to do anything. One of his godbrothers said, it is ludicrous, when Prabhupada was in the West. He said, it's ludicrous. He was already there, but he wasn't. The first year, nothing happened. So one of his godbrothers said, it's ludicrous. He said, just, you see, in Jhansi, he couldn't do anything. And now he's gone to America. He couldn't do anything in India, and he thinks he's going to do something in America. Ludicrous. Prabhupada had the faith to go on, to keep on trying. And he did it. He did what was considered impossible. Even when he brought Western devotees to India for the first time, many people said, they won't last. It won't stay. It's just they're hippies and they won't stay. But Prabhupada had the faith to keep on going. What he did was immense, unprecedented, unimaginable. It was possible because of his great faith in the order of Guru, in the order or the prediction of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is able to do that. So what is preventing us from doing it? Lack of faith. Just like no one, there are so many great devotees, they didn't believe it could be, that Krishna consciousness could be spread all over the world. So we speak to many devotees and say, oh, you can't do all that, Varnashram, isn't it? You can't do it. Why not? If Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that Krishna consciousness can be spread all over the world, Prabhupada had faith. No one else had faith to do it. Or even if they had the faith, mostly they didn't have the dedication to go and do it. So if we think, well, just like in the past, devotees thought, well, you know, maybe someone, if at all they were thinking about spreading Krishna consciousness around the world, they thought, well, maybe someone else can do it. I'll sit in Vrindavan and chant Hare Krishna. I'll go back to Godhead. So someone else can save all those people. If at all they were thinking. So you may think, well, I'm chanting Hare Krishna. I'm living in Bangalore. I'm quite comfortable. And anyway, I'm not a very big devotee. And someone else can do Varnashram. So and we often hear this. Well, in the future. Every generation, they'll say, in the future. And they'll never get done. But it shouldn't be, it should not, as Srila Prabhupada himself said, it shouldn't have been himself. He often said, why only me? He said, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave the order to every Indian, Bharata Bhumite Hoilo Manusha Janma Jag Janma Shata Kari Karo Para Upaka. He said that every Indian should take up the task of spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world. He was the one who did it. But he didn't want to be the one who did it. He wanted that many would take it up. And eventually he wrote in one letter that now the mission of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is in the hands of the Western devotees because the Indians didn't do it. So it doesn't have to. It may be one or two leaders in ISKCON are talking about it and trying to do something about it. But actually, it's an order given by Srila Prabhupada to all of his followers. Sometimes people say, well, devotees say, well, you can do it. Prabhupada didn't say everyone had to do Varnashram, but he did give this 50%. It means it's a very big order. And one who's a follower of Srila Prabhupada, he should take that very, isn't it? We should take the order of this, the order of the spiritual master is the active principle in spiritual life. We should all take it very seriously. So this is likely to be controversial because you're not supposed to say things like this. But I would say the main obstacle is that the leaders of our movement aren't taking it seriously. There are many obstacles, you could say, that, well, the laws of the land are against it. As a movement, the money is there if we want to purchase land. Now, myself, Bhakti Raghav Swami, and Shivaram Swami is in Hungary has got the whole ISKCON movement in Hungary behind it. But what we're facing is that householders themselves have to club together and buy some land, and it's just the cost of setting it up is prohibitive. But if the movement was behind it, if the whole movement was behind it, then there wouldn't be the money problem. There are so many things said, why so many excuses are given. Prabhupada himself could have also given so many excuses. Even when he was in America, he could have said, well, I came, I tried, and nothing happened. Okay, let me go back. He could have come back and said, well, I tried, but he went on going. Even though he got no encouragement from his god brothers. In the beginning, the Americans weren't responding. It took a whole year of struggling. And then something started to happen. And even Prabhupada's first followers they were far, far from the standard that we would consider of a proper ISKCON devotee now. So Prabhupada, he could have just given up, but he didn't. He went on going. So there are many obstacles, you can see. The laws of the land are in many countries, they make it difficult. The laws are geared more and more towards the big corporations, and that's coming in India with our present prime minister. He's more in, anyway, this is political bad, but he's more into corporations than Hindutva, from what I can see. He's doing more for the Ambanis and all these people than he is for the... Anyway, that's something else. People say, oh, the caste system, you're bringing back the caste system. Even some of the devotees with ISKCON, they never read Prabhupada's books. This is not the caste system of exploitation. This is guna karma vibhagashaha, society divided according to quality and activity. But people say, oh, they are bringing back the caste. Then we have to preach to them. If people say it's the caste system, we have to preach. No, this is on quality and propensity. Now, there is actually another problem there, because people are so mixed up and messed up, especially in the Western world, but it's now in this generation in India also, it's very difficult to ascertain who will be a Brahmana, who will be a Kshatriya, who will be a Vaishya, who will be a Shudra. Everyone's a Shudra in Kali Yuga. Kalo Shudra Sambhava. If someone is employed, then they're a Shudra. Now, if someone's a Vaishnava, they're more than any designation. But still, we have to make these designations. First of all, because devotees do have different natures. Even though the spiritual position of a devotee is above that of any Brahmana or Kshatriya or Vaishya or Shudra, still people have different inclinations. So in material society, if you try to make someone who can't remember one shloka of Sanskrit, if you try to make him a teacher of Sanskrit or a Brahmana, it's not going to work if he can't pronounce the shlokas and he has no inclination. He'd rather do some manual work. In the same way, if you try to make someone who is intellectually inclined to do manual work, it won't work. So that's true for devotees also. It's not that when you become a devotee, all of a sudden you're able to do everything. We still have our propensities. So that is required within Vaishnav society to make that division. Now, a Vaishnav is above the situation of a Brahmana, a Kshatriya, a Vaishya, or Shudra, but still, we should divide society so that everyone can be engaged according to their propensity. Swakarmana tamabhyacha siddhing vindati manava. Everyone, Krishna says, can attain the perfection by worshipping me and working according to their own propensity, their own work. Now, another drawback I'm just making the point that we can preach about these things. As people say, you're bringing back the caste system. No, just try to understand that this is a scientific division. Prabhupada would always use this term, scientific division, right? You've read Prabhupada's books, scientific division of society. How many times did Srila Prabhupada say that? You can make a Veda-based search. So many times. It's not arbitrary. So there are many advantages of this, that people are trained from a young age. So many people nowadays, they're trained in the school and college for one thing, and then when they come out, they do something completely different. So what was the point of all their education? It just all goes useless. I'm now past 60 years in this body. I can't remember more than... Learning English was useful, although I didn't learn all the grammar and all that. I still don't know what a past perfect... I'm not even sure. I guess it must be a verb or something. I don't even know what it is. But some things at school were useful. But years and years, I remember I studied calculus, but nowadays I can just recognize the squiggle as a calculus. I haven't got a clue what to do with it. I know there's differential calculus and there's some other kind. What's the other kind? Integral, but what it means, I haven't got a clue, although I spent years studying it. So that's just an example. I took up a career in a different line. I would have preferred, looking back, I would have preferred to go to Gurukul. What was I saying? That train people from a young age. In see their propensity and train them from the young. It makes more sense, doesn't it? Now everyone has to go to school. Why does someone who's going to drive an auto rickshaw in Bangalore have to go to school for 10 years? He has to know how to speak a little English, Hindi, Kannada, Telugu, Tamil. That's probably enough for Bangalore. Just a little of each language, which anyway they pick up, even if they come from Andhra Pradesh and start driving a rickshaw. Within a short time, they learn enough Kannada and Hindi and everything to get by. And what else? How to learn to drive an auto rickshaw. They don't teach you that in school. You can learn that in a few days. And that's all. So what does he need to learn? Oh, he needs to know how to count, right? That's all. So it's a complete waste of time putting me in the school for so many years. So it does go against the whole idea of modern society. That's another obstacle because we're all brainwashed. But then when we take to Krishna consciousness, we're supposed to read Prabhupada's books and get an education in how to live in this world so as to come out of this world. And the way to live in this world is not the way of life that modern Bangaloreans live, or anyone in the modern world. Modern lifestyle is antithetical to progress in Krishna consciousness. You can progress in Krishna consciousness, but not very satisfactorily. If you have to, most of the time your whole consciousness goes in, you have to give your life and soul to your job, your mental energies. Always think of Krishna, but you always have to think of whatever it is, writing some programs or whatever, or driving your rickshaw or whatever. So we're so tied into this society that we actually believe all this nonsense idea of progress and development, and you have to be civilized, you have to live with electricity, and you have to send your kids to a good school. A good school means it has some Christian name and charges you a lot of money. That's the main thing. The more they charge, the better you think it is. And anyway, the children, they learn how to smoke and swear and insult their teachers and have sex and take drugs, especially in the good schools. More in the good schools. So we think that's very good, very good, very nice, very civilized. In other words, we're trying to be Krishna conscious, but we're at the same time we're completely caught up in the way of thinking of a society which is actually demoniac. So that's another problem. We need to educate our devotees. Why should members of ISKCON discourage Varnashram when Prabhupada wanted it so much? What's going on here? What's wrong? Something seriously wrong. If your guru again and again and again and again and again tells you this must be done and writes about it so much in his books, and we're reading the books, and then people who are reading these books and they're supposed to be followers of Prabhupada say, no, 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 Varnashram, no, no, it's not good. Something's seriously wrong, isn't it? That's called guru ravagya. I mean, to disobey the orders of the spiritual mind. These are very heavy things I'm saying, no doubt. We're not supposed to say heavy things in this. I say. You can think about it. Am I speaking some fanatical fault-finding or Does it make sense? You think, you decide. You're all supposed to be intelligent people. You decide. We should be doing it. It's Prabhupada's order. We must do it. We should, at least, at the very least, the leaders of ISKCON should come together and say, hey, look, 50 years have gone. Prabhupada gave this order. What are we doing about it? We should do so. What are the obstacles? We should sit down and think, okay, there's this obstacle, this obstacle, this obstacle. It can be overdone because the order of the Guru, with that comes the power to fulfill it. Prabhupada, he went on preaching in the West, and I don't think anyone knows how much Prabhupada he struggled. No one knows the whole story. So many things. We read the Prabhupada Lilamrita and it all sounds very glorious, like it's some kind of movie or something. But practically, apart from the fact that Srila Prabhupada was in actually struggling with his health, physical health, all the time, apart from that, there were so many issues with disciples fighting and falling down and not understand. There's one you can read in one place. Prabhupada says, why don't you understand what I'm telling you? He's talking about farms, actually. Devotees couldn't catch up with what... He struggled so much to establish this because he had faith that my guru has given me an order. With that order, even though it seems impossible, with that order goes the ability to fulfill it. So instead of saying, no, Vanashram, can't, the leaders especially should come together and discuss, what do we have to do to fulfill this order? It can be done, Prabhupada said, it must be done. Srila Prabhupada said, if we by establishing these farms, we can take over the whole world. That's what we want, isn't it? Why should it be just a few people? The whole world should be in Krishna consciousness. So Srila, of course, he said different programs, by book distribution, by the farms, by various, all these programs together. We should come together and discuss how can it be done. It's difficult in many ways, no doubt. But it will become less difficult if we all come together and cooperate and have faith and chant the holy names together and pray to Prabhupada for guidance and discuss what can be done, what should be done. It shouldn't be the task of myself and Bhakti Raghav Swami and a few Shivaram Swami. It should be the task of the whole movement. So what is the main stumbling block is our own not doing it, our own lack of faith or lack of dedication or whatever it is. The main stumbling block is that we're not taking it seriously. All other stumbling blocks can be overcome because this is an order from the spiritual platform coming from Krishna. You may say, well, Varnashram's material. Yeah, sure, it's material. That's right. That's true. It's on the material plane. But it is the system which Krishna has given us to live in this material world, which is most favorable so that we can ascend to the spiritual world. Swakarmana tamabhyacha siddhim vindati manavaha. By swakarmana means by performing our work within this world, we can worship Him and attain all perfection. This is Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. So what kind of work? What is the best way to work within this world? So that is according to the Varnashram system. So that's the main point. We can discuss so many stumbling blocks. Everything can be overcome if we have faith that Krishna wants this. And we can have faith that Krishna wants it because he says in Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada was so much speaking about this. So that's the main stumbling block. Then other things. You please think about this and see what you can do. You might even consider that, especially those of you who are younger, you don't have to spend all your life in some nasty job in which there's no love among anyone. there's some kind of false friendship, but there's no one cares a damn about anyone else. And they'd probably be happier if the other people go down so they can go up. Or do you want to live among devotees who happily cooperate together to serve Krishna? You don't have to live in these horrible cities, which even physically, for yourself and your children to breathe the air is poisoning them. So all the big money you make, you know, I'm making so much money, you have to spend it on hospital bills. Or you may just go insane, which is another big industry here in Bangalore, the mental hospital. It's a big business, right? All the IT people go crazy. Many of them. It's a known syndrome. So you don't have to live your life in this horrible way. You can live your life having better sadhana than the devotees in the temple. You might think, well, the brahmacharis, they have good sadhana. I'll tell you, one of my disciples, he was a brahmachari for many years, and then he married and went to move on a farm. He said, my sadhana is much better on the farm because we have a very regulated life. We have three times, I'm not saying the brahmachari should all get married and go to the farm, but some of the grihasthas could consider this. We have morning program, but they don't have a class in the morning because they start work early, as is usual in the farming. Then at midday they again come together for kirtan, and then they have a lecture. Then they have again kirtan and a talk in the evening. And I suggested that instead of having philosophical talks in the evening, because all devotees are very tired from working hard, they can have Ramayana Katha or Mahabharat Katha like this, and then helps to keep the devotees awake after working hard all day. They take rest very early, automatically rise very early. You can spend your whole life like that. This devotee told me, as a brahmachari, we're running around, we're so busy, we're off. Usually we don't have an evening program, often even in the morning program, we have to go here and there, or see to this, or see to that. For sadhana, he said, it's the best. He said, I never had such good sadhana, I never had such good chanda, even though I have family and everything. So that's the main reason. Srila Prabhupada said, when we talk about vanashram, the first step is establishing farm communities. That's the first step. Actually, vanashram is such a big topic. How is it going to unfold? I don't know. It's this whole thing of dividing varnas, especially where did the kshatriyas come from? Because how can you have... It's a big question. But Srila Prabhupada said, anyway, it should be done. So the beginning is to go to the land, live simply, and chant Hare Krishna. That's the beginning. It can be done. You grihasthas, especially young grihasthas, you can think about this. And you could live your life like that. You don't have to spend your whole life living in this horrible city. It is quite possible to live without electricity. And without cell phones. But do we want it? That comes that question. Are we addicted to this city life? It's an addiction that we somehow or other people take some kind of pleasure in this intense life. And they have some feeling, yeah, I'm being successful, or they're afraid, what will other people say? So many people said to Prabhupada, oh, what is this? Ludicrous. But he listened. Instead of listening to what everyone else said, he listened to what his guru said. Even his guru had told him years before, but that order remained in his mind. And he did, even his own godbrothers, he would think, oh, these are big, big devotees. They tell him, it's ludicrous what you're doing. But he kept more faith in his guru's order than what other people said. Can vanashram properly be practiced in the modern cities of today? No. No. Modern cities are they're set up for sense gratification. Varnashram society has sense gratification, but it's not the goal of life. There's dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. The modern cities, there's only artha and kama. And there's no consideration of dharma or moksha. And of course, Krishna consciousness is beyond dharma, artha, kama, and moksha. But if we're talking about society, what are the goals of society? That they should be dharma, artha, and kama. We're not saying sense gratification is stopped, but not in this demoniac way. So, of course, there is Varnashram. Prabhupada said it's everywhere. Everywhere you'll find some intellectuals. By the way, IT work is not intellectual work. It's brain work, but it's Shudra work. It's not intellectual. Intellectual means that one should think about the subtleties, the higher nature, sattva-gun. This is at least according to the Vedic understanding. Shudras can be intelligent also, even in Vedic culture. The Kayastas, they're Shudras, they're intelligent. Even to be a charioteer on the battlefield requires a lot of intelligence. But there are different kinds of intelligence. But real intelligence means to consider the higher values of life. So this, and you can see the IT, it just makes people into, to call them a Shudra is a compliment. It's just very low class. No, really, I mean, it's not a joke, is it? It's required to be an IT worker. It's practically required that you have to be degraded, isn't it? It's the part of the social culture. It's horrible. It's subhuman. You know better than me, some of you. Somehow you're being devotees, but it's not at all a conducive environment. The most sad thing about it all is that these young boys and girls who are coming, they're not by nature bad. If they were given right association, they could become very good, but they deliberately make the atmosphere such that they become degraded worse than animals. Such a sad thing. And then they go crazy because they don't want that, but they have to act. You see the way these young boys and girls, IT, the way they act, the way they behave is just like some act, isn't it? Like they're on a, then it's not coming from inside, it's just all acting, that's all. It's crazy. It's artificial. Very artificial, the way they behave. So that's another thing, on the farm communities, you can't behave artificially because everyone sees you all the time. And there's no need to either, because devotees are satisfied. Only devotees who are serious about Krishna consciousness can stay there. So number two, within ISKCON we have only introduced the Brahmana Varna. That I disagree with. I don't think we've made proper Brahmanas. We put threads on people's shoulders, but that doesn't make someone a Brahmana. Brahmana means they shamo damata. Where's the training for that? They have to be trained as Brahmanas. Just someone's been initiated 6 months and then you may put a thread on their shoulder. That doesn't make them a Brahmana. There has to be proper training. If they're working in some job, that's also not a Brahmana. So here it says, within ISKCON we have introduced the Brahmana Varna. I disagree with that. Where are the Brahmanas? There may be a few here and there. But we haven't introduced it per se. There's no proper training for any Varna. It's just we think we're Brahmanas, that's all. How can ISKCON introduce other Varnas like Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra, if at all they should be introduced? Well, if we're talking about Varnashram, of course we're introducing about. Yeah, these are the kind of questions that come up. First of all, live a natural life. By natural, of course, then talk about living on the land, but that's not it's not natural just in the sense that you get fresh air and fresh food, but it's also that's the way human beings are meant to live. So when we start living like that, and then we can see how people's propensities come out, how to walk. It is a challenge, no doubt, because people are so messed up in the modern age, and no one wants to say, I'm a Shudra, even if they are, by propensity. This point we should understand very carefully, that a Vaishnava is above Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. But by propensity, they may have a certain kind of nature which suits them for a certain kind of job. Certain kind of... Actually, the word job is not very good. It should be certain kind of karma. When we say job, we think about being paid. But there's no payment generally there's not payment in Varnashram. So how to do that? It's not such an easy thing. It can be done within our ISKCON society to some extent, even as it is now. We could designate that, okay, some devotees will mostly study, this will be full-time devotees. But they're mostly also so busy doing so many things that all the what we call the full-time devotees, they do all the things. Like a temple president, he has to give a class, be a brahmana, then organize and administrate and discipline like a kshatriya. He has to see where the money is coming from, a vaishya. Then he has to clean the floor also many times. So he may have to do everything. So in this way, he's a Vaishnava, but still... Within our, there's a very good book I just read called Varnashram Compendium, Volume 1 by Shivaram Swami. So I don't know if that's available in India. I got it in England. But that's a very good introductory book. It's very basic, simple, straightforward. That's the first volume, which just gives a general overview, and he gives some idea of this. Anyway, should ISKCON devotees support the philosophy promoted by those who claim to be vegans? Do you all know what a vegan is? It's a vegetarian, doesn't take milk or dairy products. No. Why? Why should we? What's it got to do with Krishna consciousness? Krishna consciousness is Goraksha, milk, liquid religion. Why should we promote... Well, you may say because all the cows are being slaughtered, we shouldn't take milk from them. Then protect our cows. Have protected cows. If we'd have done what Prabhupada said, then there'd be so many protected cows and we'd be taking milk from them. So why should... Instead of promoting this veganism, which is another ism, Prabhupada used to say, all these isms. Instead of promoting another ism, we should do what we're supposed to do, which is to establish... Actually, Prabhupada wanted for every city temple there should be a farm connected, close by. And the milk can be sent into the city and made into ghee and then restaurants. Srila Prabhupada had a whole formula, whole plan. The grihasthas can be engaged, they can be engaged in the restaurants. Even, and the ghee will come, and by taking ghee, prasadam, then people will lose their taste for eating meat. Prabhupada had so many plans. He even said, don't make any more temples. You have restaurants and Bhaktivedanta reading rooms attached so people can come and read the books. Did you ever hear that? Any of you ever heard that? You never knew. No more temples, Prabhupada said. We're going on in a stereotype way, making temples, which isn't in and of itself a bad thing, but as we often see, temples, they also become centers of contention. And someone wants to be in charge and control everything and rule everything. Something like that happened in Bangalore in a very bad way. Isn't it? So in this, that's also, without having big temples, just having restaurants and reading rooms, that also removes the danger of all this prestige and all, just everyone who can... Anyway, that's another topic. How does veganism complement Vaishnava philosophy? Not in any way whatsoever. No. Our philosophy is you should protect the cow, take the milk, and ghee especially. Cow is, and her milk is absolutely part of the Vedic way of life, not just for Vaishnavas, for everyone. So the idea of Vedic society, as you know, doesn't mean only Vaishnava. It doesn't mean Sai Baba, but there's Shaivas, Garnapatyas, Shauryas, Shaktas, Mayavadis. They're all part of Vedic culture. So they all support cow protection. There's no room for this veganism at all. Should women in general be encouraged to take up different professions and become part of the market force? No, and the men shouldn't either. Why? What's our business to encourage people to take up different professions and become part of the market force? What business has ISKCON got to do that? Why should we encourage people? There may be individual cases, but it's not as a movement we encourage people, yes, build up the market force and let the country develop. This is all nonsense. Women, I have that book called Mothers and Masters. Women's body, as some people might have noticed, is meant for giving birth to children, and then they're supposed to look after the children. You're not supposed to use contraceptives. Then there should be children, more and more children. That's one way Islam is spreading, right? More and more children. Vaishnavas can do the same thing. Why not? So they have their role in society, which is to be wives, mothers, daughters, daughters-in-law, and so on. How should ISKCON promote education for women within the movement? What we do at the present time in the cities there can be educational programs for women. Women should teach women best. But the Vedic model is that, which we should seriously move toward, and which Prabhupada spoke about very clearly, he said that the girls should be married early. No Gurukul for girls. He said, oh, that'll be a disaster if boys and girls are... Actually, in the beginning, in his books, he says there may be co-education, but later on, he said... So anyway, the Vedic model is that the boy goes to Gurukul, the girl, she learns her Griha Karya, Griha Dharma at home. She also helps, she learns how to look after the young children from a very young age. And then when the boy comes back from Gurukul, he marries and he teaches the wife everything. So we find in Shastra, again and again, very famously, Lord Shiva teaches Devi. We find so many verses in which he's teaching her. It's Kardama Muni left home, so his son, he instructed his mother. So within the family, women, the Vedic model is they're within the family. That is their role, and education is not that they're not educated, but within the family. That's the general, although there have been some, in ancient times, some Brahmavadinis also, but they were exceptions. Why did Prabhupada say that women need not attend the Varnashram college? Same thing, because they have a different role. Different body, different role within society. What is the role of traditional Gurukul? Role of Gurukul is to train boys so that they don't take birth again. So that they understand the actual purpose of life. So that they have a taste for the holy names. So that they can live in Krishna consciousness all their life and preach Krishna consciousness. This is the role of the Gurukul. Why in ISKCON have we not promoted the establishment of such a Gurukul? There may be various reasons. which are given, which are valid at some level, that we tried and it didn't work. But that's not really a reason. The real reason, I don't know. Ask those who are not doing it. I'm trying to do it. I would again say it's due to... You see, it's easier to go along with the modern society. If we have schools in which we say, yes, we're affiliated with Cambridge University, and all the fools and rascals will applaud and say, very good, very good. And then they'll give donations, and they'll like us, and we'll like them, and we'll live comfortably. And if we establish actual gurukuls, and then we may have to face legal problems, and even our own, there'll be so much opposition. So it's easy, and the main reason we're not doing gurukuls, as I said, is it's easier not to do. It's easier to go with the flow of society. But if Srila Prabhupada had done that, then we wouldn't all be sitting here now. And even if he'd have gone with the flow of what his godbrothers did, he could have set up a little mutt here and had a few followers here and there. But he did, so he did what was required for the benefit of them. We should seriously think, if we are followers of Srila Prabhupada, we should think as he did, what is for the ultimate benefit of the world? And we may say, spread the holy name. Okay, but what are the programs Prabhupada gave? He also gave Gurukul, Varnashram. He gave all the... He gave, spread the holy name, distribute books, Back to Godhead magazine, Rathiatras, temples. He'd said all these things. But he also said 50% Varnashram. He also said Gurukul. So we shouldn't drop anything out. It's just like in some machine. If we leave out some... Just like you have a computer without a... Okay, we don't want a CPU. And then it doesn't work. We have no monitor. Maybe the blind people, they have braille computers. But that's not the norm. All the essential components have to be there. So if we leave out some essential components, then... If we're actually serious to spread Krishna consciousness all over the world, then we have to take this seriously. Because one thing is that we talk so many things. It's there in Prabhupada's books. This society is demoniac. And people say, well, why aren't you doing it? Well, then what's your alternative? We don't have an alternative. And then we stop saying this society is demoniac because we don't have an alternative. And then we have to change the philosophy a bit and say, well, Prabhupada said that, but we're not supposed to say that, and actually they're not really demoniac, they're all spirit souls, and so on and so on. So if we do have this positive alternative, Prabhupada said people will join our farms in the millions. And that's especially true in the Western world nowadays, where people are frustrated completely with the government. Even here in India, so many people, young men, they don't get jobs. We can come, you have to work. Come and join our farm, you have to join kirtan. We don't expect everyone to chant 16 rounds. And do work. And we'll give you food and clothing and everything. And gradually they can become devotees. Our movement would be tremendously successful if we were doing this. If we showed a positive alternative. So if we really want to spread Krishna consciousness very widely, this is the program Prabhupada gave. Millions, Prabhupada said. In Greece, they had some economic crisis that's been going on for so many years. So what are so many people doing? They're going out of the cities into their ancestral lands and growing food. Otherwise, what are you going to do? There's no money, no food. So they go on to... By force, they're doing it. In Cuba also, sanctions were given to that country. We may say, well, we're not farmers. That's another problem. We're not farmers. We don't know how to farm. So you can learn, just like someone takes a degree in one subject and does some other line. They work in another line. It's not rocket science, to use that cliche. Nowhere in any civilization in the world, in the whole of history, has farming been considered a job for the intelligentsia. It's not such a difficult thing to learn. You can learn. It's a matter of attitude that we want to do this for Prabhupada. We want to do this. You can learn. But are we ready to do it? Do we have to wait till the whole of society? Sometimes devotees say, well, we wait for the whole of society to collapse and then we'll do it. But then everyone else will be doing it, and then what will we have to show? We should be doing it now, and then we can maybe stop the whole society from collapsing. Then another question. How important are cows in the lives of ISKCON devotees? Well, you're all ISKCON devotees. You tell me, how important are cows in your life? Not much. Every householder, Prabhupada writes in the first canto, about at the end of the first canto, Shukadev, he would go in the, when the cows are being milked, and Prabhupada writes that even the poorest householder would have, what does he say, 10 cows? So everyone's supposed to keep cows. Every householder. It's his, Gauraksha is especially for the Vaishyas, but actually everyone is supposed to keep cows. That means Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, and Vaishyas. They're all supposed to. It's the duty of everyone to do so. Just like Vedic learning is for the Brahmanas. Actually, it's for everyone. The Brahmanas, they specialize. But everyone should learn what is the purpose of life from the Vedic knowledge. So Gauraksha, cow protection, is meant for everyone. It's the whole of society. Even in one place it's said that the Shudras, they should be concerned with that. So, we're living unnatural lives and far removed from the Vedic culture. What do we mean by cow culture? I guess that means Vedic culture. I don't know. I haven't heard that term much. So it should be central and important. We may say, well, you say, what happens when the cow gets old? There's maybe so many objections. Okay, agreed. There are many difficulties. Modern life is not what it used to be. It's not so easy to do all these things. At least let us come together and discuss, how are we going to do this? How are we going to fulfill this order of Prabhupada? Isn't it, as followers of Prabhupada, when you see in his books again and again and again, he talks about this. We as followers of Prabhupada should be very serious to come together and discuss and make plans and do it. Should ISKCON prepare devotees to enter politics or be involved in political matters? ISKCON as a society, that's maybe not a priority right now. Prabhupada said, first of all, to re-establish Varnashram, first of all, we have to make a society of Brahmanas. We have to make an ideal class, Brahmanas. So that's still not done, as I see. That should be done. Then we can think about that. Enter politics. The way politics now is now, it's very, very sinful and very, very corrupt. But interestingly, we do find that many politicians, amid all their corruption and exploitation, and the higher you go, the more sinful you are, and you'll be involved in murders and all this kind of thing. But they're also often very religious. They are mostly, I mean, there are exceptions. Jyoti Basu, Buddha Dev Bhattacharya, they were actually irreligious. But many of the politicians, they're also religious. I don't know exactly how their mindset works. Maybe something like the elephants bathing kind of thing. I would say at this stage, we can preach to politicians. But to go into politics, it means that unless you have a corrupt mindset, you can't function within politics because it's all corrupt. So I would say it again, as I've often said with Varnashram, I just can't give an answer right off. We have to see the situation, discuss, see if there's anyone suitable who could go into that very, very bad association and remain strong and actually be able to influence in it in a good way. We should discuss these things and see. We should do it, ultimately. Yes, we should Krishna conscious movement should be involved in all ways of society. But basically, we don't like this political system, democracy. We don't subscribe to that. Ultimately, we have to establish kings on the level of Yudhishthira. That's a big challenge, isn't it? Ultimately, it should be done. For now, we may see how to work with the democracy. But overall, it's not a very good system. How important are villages? Well, villages means people are coming together for practically we're saying how important are farms, and then the question comes, how important is food? Right? How important is food? What does Krishna say about that in Bhagavad Gita? Anad bhavanti bhutan. We need, Krishna himself is very practical. Everyone needs food. So that is required. Why is ISKCON not involved, much less involved with village development? Again, I say, we as a movement, we're lagging in this area. Why is Varnashram considered by some devotees as most important and by others as not much relevant in our present social context? It's not relevant in our present social context, I agree, but we're supposed to make it relevant. Isn't it? Just like Krishna consciousness, it didn't exist in the Western world. And it wasn't, Krishna consciousness wasn't an important religious movement even within India. Prabhupada made it important, so we should make it important. We should bring it to the attention of others. Did Prabhupada want Varnashram established only for non-devotees, those outside of our ISKCON society, or is it also meant for our ISKCON devotees? Srila Prabhupada wanted it within ISKCON also, that ISKCON devotees should take the lead in showing how to do it. How important is establishing gurukuls and Varnashram colleges? I just commented on that briefly. Can you comment on the statement that Vedic culture is primarily meant to be an agrarian culture? Well, all cultures, again, anad bhavanti bhutani. However big cities you have, ultimately you have to rely on food. So the food is not grown in the cities. So all societies are agrarian, but the modern, the machine society has made agriculture so that you can do it with a few people, with lots of machines and lots of chemicals. Whereas traditionally, agriculture is labor intensive. So yeah, Vedic culture is agrarian culture. Yeah. Simple way of life. More machines means you have to have mines and factories to make the machines. Then you make more and more machines and always thinking of new machines to make. But then what Prabhupada said, the factories are dungeons for demons. He also suggested how the factories, they can be Krishnaized by having kirtan and this and that. But overall, Prabhupada also said the factories won't stop, at least immediately. He was pragmatic in that sense. But at the same time, he wanted our movement to make a lead. In the Vedic culture is primarily agrarian cultures. Of course, there are cities in Vedic culture. Dwarka was a city. Hastinapur, these are cities. So there were cities also. Many women within our ISKCON society have serious reservations about implementing Varnashram. So do men also. Many men also. How to address their fears and apprehensions? Well, by discussing in this way. And establishing communities and showing that it can be done and it should be done. That's the best way. Example is better than precept. But precept should be there also. So, Hare Krishna, I went quickly through these questions.